that on Wednesdays, out here on our patio, we do a very special thing. At 10:30 in the morning, we have something called PG&E, which stands for People Gabbing and Eating, not the power company. It used to be called Prayer Gabbing and Eating, but now it's sort of morphed into something a little bit different because we don't all have necessarily Christians who are meeting here on our patio, and not everybody wants to pray. So, but everybody are people, unless some of us bring our little poochies sometimes. Sassy's never made it yet, but I'm hoping Max will get to meet her soon. So we have this PG&E that happens every Wednesday at 10:30 in the morning. And it follows a very busy morning here in the sanctuary, here in Lockheed Hall over there, and in our bathrooms, when a group of mentally and developmentally challenged men and women come with their job coaches and they clean this place. They scrub, they vacuum, they do the bathrooms. They even clean your hymnals. They do that about once a month. So take a look at how nice and clean they are, okay? So they clean up a storm in here, these folks. And then we gather on the patio, those folks, and some of the people from our church, Sierra Christian, and we have a time of breakfast and fellowship and music, and it is just fun. So a couple of weeks ago, we were nearing the end of our PG&E. It was about 11:20 or so. And I heard this familiar question. Gail, my new friend Michael said to me, "Gail, did you bring your guitar today?" And I said, "Michael, I did bring my guitar." You see, there were a few weeks when I didn't have my guitar. I was in the shop. So the answer was, "No, I don't have my guitar still. Sorry, Michael." But this time, yes, I have my guitar. It's back. It's fixed. It's good to go. And he said, "Oh, good. Can I stand next to you and sing today?" And I said, "Of course you can, Michael." And I had the music stand out there. I got my guitar. And so I started playing, and Michael's singing with me. Some of the same songs you guys know. And we're singing. And then pretty soon, Michael's friend Albert, he comes up. And Albert wants to sing too. And so we're singing. And then, an unlikely candidate for singing came up, a gal named Allie. And Allie is someone who suffers from some really severe challenges. So she comes up to me and she says, "I want to sing the Rainbow Connection." "I want to sing the Rainbow Connection." Yeah, that's it. That's exactly it. You know, are you familiar with this song? Mm-hmm. This is a Muppet song. This song was sung by Kermit the Frog.
Yep.
Okay? All right. You've seen some of you, my pink binder full of songs I know how to play, right? Okay. So I got my pink binder. That song's not in it. Rainbow Connection. Church song. So I'm thinking, well, I said, "Allie, you know, I don't know how to play Rainbow Connection. I don't have the music." And she said, "I want to sing Rainbow Connection." And I said, "Okay." Her job coach said, "It's okay, Gail, just play whatever you want to play. She'll sing it. She knows every word." So I was like, okay. I just opened up my binder and I started playing whatever, just random songs, chords, this and that. And Allie belted out the most beautiful rendition of the Rainbow Connection I've ever heard. I mean, it was incredible. I think she sang it like two or three times. It went on for a while. But she knew every single word. Clearly, beautifully. And at the end of that, everyone started clapping. And there were probably like 25 people out here at least, I'd say. 25 people. Everyone's clapping, and Allie is beaming. Okay. Oh, it was a beautiful scene. Allie's happy now. She's sung the Rainbow Connection, so she goes and she sits back down. And then God sends a thought into my head. Here's the thought. God says, ask Tara to sing. Michael had sung, Albert had sung, Allie had sung. Ask Tara to sing. Okay, now here's something about Tara, guys. You don't know Tara. Tara cleans our bathrooms, by the way. She's responsible for our beautiful bathrooms. I think she does a better job than when we were paying people to do the bathrooms. These guys are volunteers. So Tara cleans our bathrooms. Tara is blind. Tara can actually kind of see if you put something like that in front of her, then she can see. But Tara's blind. And so I'm hearing from God, ask Tara to sing. And so this all happened really quickly, but it's this little dialogue, you know? God's messengers, sometimes they have dialogues with the person who sends them, with God. And so I go, wait, but Tara's blind. How's she gonna see the words on the page in my binder? The answer is, ask Tara to sing. Okay, I hope I'm not paying attention to her disability. I'm going to make her feel uncomfortable. I don't know. I had thought a million different reasons why I should do this. Ask Tara to sing. I asked Tara to sing. And lo and behold, Tara said, yes. I would never have expected it. Tara said, yes. She goes, I listen to the fish radio. That's Christian radio, kind of like Kayla. I listen to the fish, and I know a lot of these songs. I don't know all the lyrics, but I can try. So I said, well, let's go. So she came up, she stood next to me, and we began to sing together. And you know, it was kind of a fake it till you make it deal, but it was great. And at the end of our song, everyone started to clap again, just like they had for Allie and the rainbow connection. And when the clapping subsided, I heard this exclaimed, this is better than church! Someone sitting out there in that gathering, in that little assembly, said, this is better than church! And immediately, I thought two things. A, I thought, well, this is church, right? Wherever two or more are gathered. Okay, this is church. But then it occurred to me too, ack, what is that saying about church? Right? Like, oh, double-edged sword. And so I started thinking about that. You know, what's going on out here in PG&E is like there is this group from the outside that have come in, this group of people who at best are tolerated or barely accepted, at worst are totally rejected because they're different. The world is afraid of them. And so here's this forum where people are coming together and they're totally themselves and they're totally loved and they're totally welcomed. And then here's this group of insiders, some of you. And they're there too. And they're a part of this. And they're clapping and they're smiling. Things are happening. It's like this flow. It's like this spontaneity is going on. It's like, who knows what's going to happen? Sometimes there's a song, sometimes there's a guitar, sometimes we pray, sometimes we don't. It's happening. And I thought, what has happened to our notion of church? What's happened to our notion of church? A few months ago, I mentioned that survey that went out, right, of Christians and non-Christians, and what came back from the survey when people were surveyed about, well, what do you think about church? And what came back was, well, church is a place that, you know, you're going to get judged. Church is a place where you have to be perfect. And church is a place where you have to conform to the rules. It's very orderly and dignified. We got that. together and have like a town meeting, essentially. That was your ecclesia. It was a town meeting. It was a place for the men of the community to come together and decide something. Like, we need to fix that road. Or we need to build that building over there. So come on, men, let's all decide on it. We're all equals. We all have a voice. That was an ecclesia. A group of people that gather together to decide something. Men. And of course, the Christians, the early Jesus followers, well, they co-opted the term ecclesia. They co-opted so many things, didn't they, throughout the years. They co-opted that term that just meant men coming together to decide something. And they said, well, let's call our ecclesias the place where men and women come together, not to decide something necessarily, but to worship something. That's our ecclesia, our church. It's a place where everyone is equal. The town planner, the town prostitute, the richest guy, free man, and the slave. The Jew, the Gentile, they're all going to come together in an ecclesia, and they're going to worship the God that was revealed in Jesus Christ. They're going to welcome those people from the outside who don't know this God yet. They're going to learn to walk in the footsteps of Jesus Christ. They're going to do the work of healing and wholeness in the world, and they're going to witness to God's glory. That's what they did in their churches, in their ecclesia. And can you imagine? Imagine what would have happened if this typical outside idea of what church is had been the prevalent idea back then about those early churches. Imagine if people on the outside had been looking in and saying, oh, those people, they're going to judge us. They might not accept us. We have to be perfect before we go there. Do you think it would have spread? I mentioned a few months ago about how the Roman Empire, the religious authorities were doing everything they could to stamp out Christianity, right? They were trying to stop, I said, it's like the game of whack-a-mole. Every time they would crush churches, more would pop up somewhere else. They couldn't stop it. Because what was happening inside these ecclesia was so transformative. They couldn't stop it. It was like a virus spreading. And so Pat read a little piece of the book of James. And it's so important for churches today, and it was important for churches then. We're going to look in the next few weeks more at the book of James. But you can already get a sense, even in chapter 1, that, and this is probably putting it kindly, not all's well in some of these churches that James was writing to. Not all's well. And so he writes to them, and he's trying to help them get themselves back on track. You see, there was this idea that was popular at the time, and it's still around today. This idea that goes a little something like this. To be saved, all I have to do is say, God, I believe in you and your son, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I'm saved. Now I'm free. I don't have to follow the law. I don't have to do anything special, say anything special. I'm free. I'm saved. Yay for me. And in fact, that's what we just heard in that little piece of scripture. And Pastor James is saying, sorry guys, there's a disconnect. Because if you think that you are saved simply because of your faith, and then what's happening out of that faith is the fruit of our faith is, well, the kind of stuff that James was talking about. The kind of stuff that was stirring up in these churches. Well, they missed the bolt. And I think, you know, what if you opened up the book of James? What if you come up here, Pat, and read, okay, so this is from the first chapter of James. Imagine if it said this. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, I hear that things aren't going so well for you in your churches, and you're being mean to each other and excluding some people, and you're not caring for some of them and loving each other as you're supposed to. But it's okay because you all have faith and you all believe, so you're all saved. Amen. Peace be with you. Can you imagine? That would never be in our Bible, would it? It would just be there in their Bible. No, Pastor James writes this letter because he is doing what a good pastor has to do. He's identifying that something is awry. And he's beginning the process of pulling back that band-aid that evidently these churches had been putting over their wound. And he's pulling off the band-aid. And he's not just adding a little salve to it. He's starting to dig deep, and he's asking them to dig deep too. It's time to clean out the wound. He's doing the work of a good pastor, Pastor James, because he knows the goal of our faith is not simply just to do whatever we want. The goal of our faith is to truly be free. Not so that we are free, but so all are free. And it's not willful anymore. It's not, I want you to be free and I'm going to love you because I'm supposed to. That's the disconnect. It's, I want you to be free and I'm going to love you. Because God wants me to be free, and God loves me, and God has freed me. That's the supernatural progression. That's the goal. The free life. It's not the law, it's the law of liberty. Pastor James, different translations, they call it the law of freedom, the free life, the law of liberty. That is the goal. And the thing is that the really good news is that that liberty is as close as our breath. It's as close as your breath. As close as your heartbeat. It's right there. It's not an illusion. You know, Ali's song, The Rainbow Connection, that song, it says, some people say that rainbows are just illusions, but I don't believe it. I think there's another side, and someday I'll find it. The truth about that freedom that's ours is that someday, it's already here. It's real. And when we hear that word, and when we act on that word, in our families, in our churches, in our neighborhoods, in the community, in the wider world, that's when we're never, ever going to hear again, this is better than church. We will only be able to hear, nothing is better than church. Ali can see it. Tara can see it. Can we see it? Can we live it? My prayer is that him say yes. Amen.
Yeah.